to worship. It is MEA weekend, which means that it feels like the whole world has gone on vacation. So I'm delighted that you are here and that together we get to worship God in this place and beyond this place. Just by way of announcements, I want to remind you that a week from today we're offering a trunk or treat party, which means we hope that you will decorate the trunk of your car, park it in our parking lot, bring some candy. Children will get in costume. They will come along and they will go to the trunk of your car and you will give them candy and they will be very happy. I'll tell you why we do this. We do this because last year we had, 300, 400 people from the neighborhood come and discover that Christ United Methodist Church is alive, 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 and that we like chocolate and fun. And that we welcome all people. So please, whether you decorate the trunk of your car, you can look it up on Pinterest, or whether you just come to be part of the party, please show up, because the more people here, the better the gathering. So that's just a little plug for that a week from today. I want to celebrate with you the courage of two of our 80-year-old members who decided that they love each other enough to covenant love with each other. And so Wes and Joanne celebrated their covenanted love service. And will you rise so we can congratulate you? Bravo. So I just want you to let them bear witness to the fact that we're never done in life. Love swoops in the craziest times. And we get to say yes with all that we are. So anyway, congratulations to the two of you. I think that I know in my own heart I'm needful of this opportunity to stand before God and give thanks for all that is. So we rise as you're able and let us join in singing.
This moment, we want to rest in awareness that we are grateful.
We want to attend to your spirit, attend to our spirits and our souls. You invite us to rest in this moment. God, we are here this morning to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. We pray that the tectonic plates of your work in this church will be on the move. Give us courage as we step into our call. Help us to see clearly and listen well to each other's stories and needs. May we run right past our comfort zones into life-giving challenge. God, we are here this morning ready to shout. We want to shout your praise for bringing us together for new life, for the work of mercy and justice happening right here and right now. We want to shout and bring goodness into being where there is pain. We shout out in empathy and pain, knowing that you hear us. We shout for those being carried away by their burdens and challenges right now because of tragedy and natural disaster, people who are literally losing everything they own, or people who feel like they're losing everything. Pray you help us to keep walking with feet squarely planted towards hope, towards healing and community that will help one another to the ends of the earth with a grace that passes understanding. We're thankful for our scriptures, for the story of Jesus, for tradition. And in the name of this tradition, we take time to pray with one voice together the prayer of Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Oh, children forward this morning for our time with children, and I want everyone in this whole room to shout out while they're coming up. I want you to shout out the name of the holiday coming up next week. What is it? You're going to be a construction truck? I don't know how that outfit's going to work, but that sounds wonderful. Are any of you dressing up for Halloween? Any of you guys? Guys and girls? Yeah, you're dressing up for Halloween. That's going to be wonderful. Well, something I used to do when I was younger for Halloween is I'd go trick-or-treating with my cousin. My cousin is one of my favorite people in the whole world, and we'd go trick-or-treating, and then you know what we'd do afterwards? We would trade candy. Right? Because we had different kinds of candy that we liked, right? And so we'd actually lay them all out and sort them by color and all these things, and then we'd sort of march them like little people towards each other, and then we would trade candy. You think that was fun? Is that something like fun? Yeah. But you know what I would do when I would get my candy back home? What would I do? Actually, that's not true. I didn't eat it. I would hide it in my closet for a year. I didn't really like candy that much when I was little. I didn't really eat a lot of sugar, and so I would just put it in a bucket, and then I would leave it in my closet all year. Is that very fun? No, that's not very fun. I wasn't very fun as a child. So I have an unrelated question. Actually, it will be related. We'll talk about it. But what is this? A yo-yo. Have you used a yo-yo before? Some of you want to try? We've got a couple of these, but here's the lesson I learned today, and that you can learn today, too, is that you don't buy yo-yos from the dollar store. Okay? So if you want to try it, but I don't believe you're going to have much luck with it, okay? So what's the purpose of a yo-yo? What do? You throw it down, yeah, right? And then it comes back up, right? Yeah. Well, what we're going to do is we're going to give one of these each to each of your classes. So you guys can all take turns in your Sunday school class today trying out the yo-yo. But here's the thing. What happens if you just hold on to the yo-yo? Does anything happen if you hold on to it? What do you have to do in order to do a yo-yo? What do you do? Yeah, so you have to let it go down, right? You have to surrender the yo-yo, right, in order for it to be fun. Otherwise, just like how when I had my candy in the closet, it wasn't doing anybody any good, right? It was just getting old, and that wasn't good. But when we share what we have, when we let go the things that are fun, we start this cycle of energy and all sorts of good things. So the next few weeks, we're going to be talking a little bit about giving and sharing. And it's not just about things like money that we give, but we also give our energy and our time and our smiles and our opinions and our feelings to people, right? There's all sorts of ways that we give to each other. And it's much more fun if we let go of the yo-yo, if we give ourselves to other people, if we give what we have to other people, because it's much more fun when we're sharing, right? All right, let's have a prayer. Thank you, God, for yo-yos and dollar stores. And we're thankful for kids and Halloween and fun. Help us to be a people who are generous in sharing ourselves with each other, being vulnerable, letting go of our feelings and opinions and our resources. Help us to give love and smiles to each other every day. Amen. Amen. All right, so each of you in different classes, we'll let these Sunday school teachers each take one of these yo-yos so that you can all try it in your classes, okay?
I'm sure they're very grateful, Katie.
Yeah. Hey, I was thinking of doing bouncy balls, so you should be grateful.
That's what happens when you don't have to go with them. Well, this business of understanding where our blessings come from is crucial to our faith lives. The book of Deuteronomy is a series of teachings. You remember the story of the Hebrew people. They were in bondage in Egypt. God heard the cry of the oppressed and led them into freedom, but it wasn't won easily. right? They spend 40 years, which is Bible speak, for a really long time in the desert. And they knew hunger, and they knew thirst, and they knew terror. And yet God led them into a land of milk and honey and gave them lessons and commandments to live by. The Ten Commandments is part of the book of Deuteronomy. And so what I want to share with you is a crucial part of the teaching from Deuteronomy, which is this: once you're no longer terrified, once you've made it to a land flowing with milk and honey, do not become complacent. Do not forget who it is that has given you all that you have. So this is a pertinent lesson for you and for me, for sure. Moses speaks to the people of Israel. Make sure that you do not forget God, your God. But by keeping God's commandments, God's rules and regulations that I command to you today, make sure that when you eat and are satisfied, build pleasant houses and settle in, see your herds and your flocks flourish and more money come in, watch your standard of living go up and up, make sure that you do not become so full of yourself and your things, your yo-yos, right, that you forget about God, your God. The God who delivered you from Egyptian slavery, the God who led you through that huge and fearsome wilderness, those desolate arid badlands crawling with fiery snakes and scorpions. We all know what it feels like to be in those places of desperation. Moses continues, the God who gave you water gushing from a rock, the God who gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never heard of, in order to give you a taste of the hard life, to test you so that you would be prepared to live well in the days ahead of you. If you start thinking to yourself, I did this all by myself. I am rich and it's all mine. Well, think again. Remember that God, your God, gave you the strength to produce all of this wealth so as to confirm the covenant that God promised to your ancestors as it is today. If you forget God, your God, and start taking up with other gods, serving and worshiping them, I'm on record right now as giving you firm warning. That will be the end of you. I mean it. Destruction. You will go to your doom, the same as the nations that God is destroying before you. Doom, because you won't obey the voice of God, your God. May God add a blessing to this powerful reminder of the source of all goodness. And we're going to rise and sing our gratitude for goodness.
Thank you.
back. Let us enter into this time of offering.
Thank you.
Christ. And what he is seeking for Timothy to understand is words are one thing, but we live our discipleship with our whole selves, with our time, our talents, our gifts, our service, our witness, our attitudes, what we choose to listen to, what we choose to do with the gift of our lives. So here's what Paul has to say to Timothy. A devout life does bring wealth, but it's the rich simplicity of being yourself before God. Since we entered the world penniless and will leave it penniless, if we have bread on the table and shoes on our feet, that's enough. But if it's only money that leaders are after, they will self-destruct in no time. Lust for money brings trouble and nothing but trouble. Can I hear an amen? Yes. Going down that path, some lose their footing in the faith completely, and they live to regret it bitterly ever after. But you, Timothy, man of God, run from your life, from all of this. Pursue a righteous life. And a righteous life is this, a life of wonder, a life of faith, a life of love, a life of steadfastness and courtesy. Run hard and fast in the faith. Seize the eternal life, the life that you are called to, the life you so fervently embraced in the presence of so many witnesses. Tell those who are rich in this world's wealth to quit being so full of themselves and so obsessed with money, which is here today and gone tomorrow. Tell them instead to go after God, who piles on all the riches we could ever manage, to do good, to be rich in helping others, to be extravagantly generous. If they do that, they will build a treasury that will last, gaining life that is truly life. And oh, my dear Timothy, guard the treasure that you were given. Guard it with your life. Avoid, as Eugene Peterson puts it, avoid the talk show religion and the practiced confusion of the so-called experts. Would you say we're living in a day of practiced confusion of so-called experts? Avoid it, says Paul. People caught up in a lot of talk can miss the whole point of what faith is all about. May overwhelming grace keep you. May God add a blessing to the reading of this word. Would you pray with me, please? Archer's praying. God of all life, we thank you for the abundant blessings. We thank you for a time in which we get to revel and be in awe. The wonder that is this life. May the words of my mouth, may the thoughts and the yearnings of each heart present here and throughout your creation be a witness to our belief in your generous grace. These things we pray. Amen. So here is my own personal vision, or version, of I walked through 20 miles to school through head-deep snow. This is my story. Are you ready? All right. Thank you. So I had the considerable luxury of staying home with my children when they were young. It was a luxury. Some days that got very long, and when my patience got a little short, I sometimes wondered if my kids were better off for that or not. But that is what I was able to do. Their dad was a teacher who earned extra money because he was a high school teacher. You know how wildly, extravagantly they are paid. But he directed drama shows at the high school. We sang on the Vista Fleet every Friday and Saturday night in Duluth. You know, if you've ever been on the Vista Fleet, every time I smell diesel now, I think of that adventure. But so we were careful about managing our money because there wasn't a whole lot of it. Things felt pretty tight. And I realized how tight things were in the following way. One day, we were at Target, the holy mecca of consumer goodness. And my daughter Rachel, who was just a little squirt at that time, she was able, on this particular Target trip, to choose her own brand new toothbrush. And as we were checking out, she could not have been more excited about that new toothbrush. She said over and over as it was being scanned, "Oh, Mom and Dad, thanks for the toothbrush." And I didn't think much about, you know, the extravagance of her gratitude until I saw the clerk kind of looking at us strangely. And responding to my daughter's excitement, she took in my toe-headed little girl's thrilling over a new toothbrush, and she must have wondered what kind of a rough life this little one had. And she said to us, "Wow, I don't think I've ever checked out a child who was so excited about a toothbrush. That's pretty cool." So why do I tell you this story? I tell you this story because I do not ever want to become so complacent and so privileged that I forget what a new toothbrush can mean to a child. My own child or anybody else's child. The book of Deuteronomy shared with us today a strong message about remembering just that sort of thing, remembering that everything we think that we own, whether it's behind a locked door, in a bucket, our chocolate, all these things that we think are ours, all of these things are flat out gifts from God. The God who leads us through the literal and the figurative deserts of our life. We've all been in places of deep pain and deep need. The God who hears the cry of the oppressed, and the God who calls us as followers of that God to hear the cry of the oppressed. The God who teaches us over and over and over again that our love for things, for land or money or privilege, that love will warp our souls and it will ruin our peace if we let it. I'll tell you how I know. This morning, I get up at 5:10 to the minute on Sunday mornings, and I walk out and I get the New York Times. That's my Sunday treat along with the Star Tribune. And what was in the New York Times this morning? A whole magazine full of watches. And I saw that and I thought, oh, those are beautiful. And I thought, oh, Elizabeth G., what are you worshiping here? Our God speaks to us. When you who are hungry have eaten your fill, and you have built fine houses, and you live in them, and your silver and your gold is multiplied, then do not exalt yourself, forgetting the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. Do not say, our scriptures say, that it was our own power and our own hands that have gotten us the wealth that we enjoy. Let us understand this. You and I, do you remember in the book of Genesis, the first thing from the get-go? We are created in whose image? Come on, we're created in whose image? God's image, yes. And is God generous? Yes, so what are we called to be, we who are images of that generous God? We are called to be generous, right? God is generous beyond our ability to name or comprehend. It is too big. My daughter's 33rd birthday was yesterday. How did that happen that I was blessed with that girl, right? There's no way I can say thank you enough to God. That's just a smidgen of the generosity with which I live day by day. What God is telling us is that we as God images are to be generous in the way that God is generous. We are called to be generous images of the generous God who has given us all that we have and all that we bit of this teaching from Deuteronomy in it. The name of the movie is called The End. Anybody remember seeing this movie? All right, so there. In the film, Burt Reynolds becomes despondent. He decides he's had enough. He doesn't want to live anymore, and he's going to end the pain of his life by swimming out as far as he can into the sea until he is exhausted and he can just let go and he can sink under the surface of the water and be done with things. So he's a good swimmer. He swims a long ways out, a very long ways out. But after going under the surface of the water and deciding he's done, he finds himself looking up at the dapple of the sun on the water and the clouds and the sky and the blue sky, and he decides he doesn't want to die at all. So he changes his mind, and he emerges from the water, and he yells out to anyone, including his God, who can hear, saying, "I want to live!" Amen! Man, you can't cue that up. That's a preacher. "I want to live," says Burt Reynolds. So he begins to try to swim back ashore. And it is a very long way. As he begins to swim, he begins talking to God, which many of us do when we're terrified. So what he does is he promises that he will obey all the Ten Commandments every day of his life, but then he realizes that he doesn't know the Ten Commandments. So he promises God that he's going to learn the Ten Commandments. And then, in his panic, he says, "Lord, if you will get me through this, I will give you 80% of everything that I have." Well, time passes, and he continues to swim toward shore, and he's still making progress, so much so that he can just barely see the land in the horizon. He's certainly still at risk, but he's feeling a little more confident that maybe he's going to make it to shore. So he says this to his good listening God. He says, "Lord, if you get me to shore alive, I will give you 10% of everything I have." Finally, he struggles to the place where he sees that he can get his feet on firm ground again. And he says, "Lord, let's just forget about what I said before. I think I can take it here on my own from now." Tell me that's not the message of the text from Deuteronomy, right? Tell me we don't make those deals with God all the time in our lives. But what we are called to know from our scriptures is that being generous is not about making deals with God. It's not about getting a smiley sticker on your attendance chart, right? Being generous means that we are the image of God who is generous in the ways that God is generous, because we are images of that generous God, and it's not about trying to earn our way into anything. We get to be generous because we have been so abundantly blessed, and we can't bear to hold all that goodness to ourselves. We have to share it, because each of us in this place would not be here if we had not received. Right? We have all received so much. We have received skin, and we have received touch, and we have received children, and we have received love, and we have received fall leaves swirling in a humid kind of an air, and we have received the gift of God's love made flesh in our beloved Jesus, who knelt at the feet of his friends and said, "Here, how can I pour myself out for you?" We give because we can. And it doesn't feel in our giving like we're being generous. What it feels like is we're being alive. Right? So we give love and attention and care, and we practice the honest hard work of checking in with ourselves about which God it is we exactly worship. Is it the God of lovely watches? Or is it the God who says, "Would you let it go? There's a lot of love needing to be lived." So the Burt Reynolds movie is no joke, right? We know this.
Our culture and our arrogance can have us believing that we have made it as far as we have through our own strength and our own bootstraps or our own whatever. And you know that if we live that message consciously or unconsciously, we are denying God. It's nonsense. None of us got where we got in life by ourselves. We all thrive because of the generosity of our God and as the way that generosity is lived in those with whom we share life and some with whom we've never met. So here's the thing. You've heard a lot about this Transform Capital campaign. You'll be getting a brochure in the mail this next week about the Transform Capital campaign. And what that Capital campaign is about is how is it we will be images of God in a way that is generous right here in the stirring city of Rochester. We have an amazing abundance in this building, in your hearts, and in the things that God has blessed us with. We are rich people. I am rich. You are rich. Our church feels called to open up a child care and family resource center on the lower level of our building called Thrive. And we are commencing to do just that. We are asking each person who is affiliated with this church to pray fervently, God, what is it that you want to do through me? Our church wants to provide support for people who are doing the holy and hard work of raising our future. Because if we do not take care of children, we are practicing desecration of God's abundant generosity. Our church is called by the heart and the gospel of Jesus Christ to work to break the cycle of poverty that keeps too many in this community living the grinding stresses of scarcity, food insecurity, housing insecurity, employment insecurity, nurture insecurity. Children's bodies bear the scars of poverty for the rest of their lives. Did you know that? Poverty and the stress of poverty changes our very bodies when we experience it. And once experienced, those children carry the vestiges of that stress into the rest of their lives. We don't want that to be part of that. So of course, we're taking what we've been given by the people who have loved this church for 160 years, by the people who have worshiped God through this congregation. We want to share and be generous because our purpose is to worship God with our hearts and our minds and our souls, and we want to practice generosity because we can, right? Because we are so grateful that we get to be generous in the way that our God is generous with us, because we don't ever want to become so complacent. This is the lesson of the Target store, remember? We do not ever want to become so complacent in our wealth that we forget what a new toothbrush or a safe environment to learn life can mean for our children and for the children who are not our biological children, but are the children that God has called us to be graced for. What a mighty church. What a mighty God we serve. We're about the business of transformation in the way of Jesus Christ. Are you grateful? Just say yes! Yes. All right then, let's sing.
Thank you.
With that image before us, Jesus as the Good Shepherd, inspired by the love and the vision of his forebear David, and that legacy, that witness is ours to take up and to sing as best we can. As you leave today, you'll be given a bookmark of that window, an image of that window. It has all kinds of fabulous facts on it. Part of our capital campaign is protecting that window. We want to create a protective system so that water doesn't hurt it, so that nothing messes with that icon, because it tells a story, doesn't it? The powerful Good Shepherd who calls us to be compassion and grace in the world. Go in the peace and the power of that Christ. But I got to tell you something. The postlude today is nothing to miss. So get your bookmark after the postlude. Amen!